All right, so next up, we have Daniel O'Neill. Daniel O'Neill is a peer analyst. His greatest pleasure is teasing out core truths from complex systems, then developing patterns, principles, and methods to help people handle those systems better. After leaving graduate school where he studied evolution of language, Daniel entered the private sector working in publishing, mortgage, pharmaceutical, and online advertising industry. On this journey, he's helped companies with online marketing strategy, web analytics, business process modeling, strategic planning, and software development. Daniel joined the Entertainment Group in 2005. Welcome, Daniel. Very, very, very. I spent about 2 years
five parts, okay? First of all, we're going to talk a little bit about architecture as it is in making things. We're going to talk about how that concept works. We're going to talk about where architecture is in software, because the words use a lot, but I don't necessarily get confused in the real environment. We'll talk about how I enrich a software, and then we'll talk about what I think is going to be the future of software. So the first thing I want to talk about really briefly is that I went back to the historical survey of how things get made and trying to make sense of it. Because Tug has an architectural method. Tug always talks about building things, basically making things as if they were talking about architecture. So it's an interesting place to start. And what I came up with was that there were three major disciplines that can be an engineer. They aren't necessarily always craft, engineering, and architecture. They are really, really interesting and important and very, very different. Craft, or design, to me, is materials, the understanding and the creation and production of things, particularly when it's on materials, and we're working with those materials, what the engineers use to call the plastic arts. And what's really interesting about that, they don't do things, they test a lot of different techniques, they build prototypes, they make an idea of what something engineers are working on the application of science and mathematics to create conceptual, replicable concepts that can be used to make things consistent, basically standards and processes. And so what you get with engineering is formal models, and they look rely heavily on analytics, logic, and mathematics. And then architects are trying to model this, trying to tell a broadly understood story that can bring together the entire project, not necessarily to solve all the problems. But to create a synthesis of concepts that can be understood by everybody working on it. So they create what I call dumb problems. And I don't call them dumb because they're a bad idea to have, simply because they are designed to achieve the basic idea that can be understood together. So it's not designed to be truly perfect or formal, and it's definitely not going to be defined for a tech. So each discipline's knowledge base and detailed techniques are domain specific, and the high level process is larger than the area. What I mean by that is people, engineers, think about engineering. Now, they solve problems differently, right? An engineer in a nautical environment is going to do a lot more about water and flotation and the movement of liquid. And sometimes in a building environment is going to know a lot more about forces and resistance and resistance. But they both rely on standards, processes, and mathematics. And what that means is they each think about the world in a very specific way. This is the craft or designer way of thinking about the world. The unbuilt world cannot be built world. Craft discovered world that working with materials around them. They have deep respect for the various materials that they represent. They don't assume they know how something is going to work until they work on it. This is a typical edge software. I don't think you guys have ever heard of these. This is actually all this stuff on here is a feature, not a book. This is a really, really good edge software. Okay? What you're seeing here is it's a sparseness, it's an invitation to build something in the world. Little work as possible to go into the planning for that work. In other words, the craft of making the things where all of the understanding would come from. This is basically a box within which you can understand. And the reason that many developers discovered this set to these overplanning of work that can create bad software. So they said, we're not going to do that. We're going to scope a place to do this work, and then we're going to work back together and solve that problem in a digestible chunk, and you'll get something good. That's the craft of intent. There's a little bit of tension here when you talk about engineers, right? We will understand everything first. Engineers rely on standards and replicable processes to create quality, consistency, efficiency of manufacturing. They believe the world can be understood first and then reapplied in different contexts. So when software development's perspective is mostly seen in the planning parts of projects, project management is what is commonly called enterprise software architecture. And one of the reasons for that is the very first computer is a giant engineering project. So there was a lot of engineering thinking because it was so close to the metal and the mechanics of actually running the electrons around. Architects believe that standards and materials are important. More specifically, they believe that work is best done in the right context once there's agreement of the higher level goals of the project. So thinking here at Tug all the time is what or how it affects the challenge to each other. Are you doing the what or the how? And where the what is aligned to understanding of the project as expressed through blueprints and high-level specifications. A blueprint is a some way that things got built without at least one of these disciplines. Right? And what I discovered was, if you go back far enough, you find that architecture as a formal discipline was always part of projects within this movement. The first architect, as we think of them, in the Western world, anyway, I don't know much about what happened in these, is the Truvis. Truvis was a Roman architect around 70 BC. He wrote a book about architecture that frankly considered part of an architecture of the Roman class. And architects and architecture abounded in the Republic. People identified themselves as such in the Republic, basically to fall of Rome. But after that, it really wasn't a self-describing architect in Europe. So, what happened? Things were clearly getting built. How is this possible? So I asked three questions. How do things get built when they aren't built? What needs for building is architecture suit? And how did architecture get added to the active building? Sorry,
I think your sound is still not great.
All right, I'm going to take this one.
You
want
to move
over
here?
I really want.
Okay.
How do
you guys grab? Is that better? I'm so sorry. I didn't realize it was still not.
Okay.
All
right.
Let us know if you're having any problems.
And all staff can also be there as well. How do things get built if there are no architects? Well, this is the Chartreuse Cathedral in France. It was started in 1193 and largely completed in 1250. It's considered to be a profound innovation in architecture. In building cathedrals, it's got these fine buttresses that allow the walls to be a lot less strongly reinforcing and giant, gorgeous windows. There's endless amounts of crafts and engineering in this. But as far as anybody can tell, there was no main architect in this project. There was basically all of this gorgeous was happening without some generating blueprint. The reason for that is already busted. Right? This is a known about plan. It was the expected form for all cathedrals of the time. Basically, cathedrals have an entry at the bottom, was a stylized cross, with a pulpit at the top of the cross, and outwards on each side. So this basic plan is modified extensively in different cathedrals, but at the time, you know, you get different contributions from engineers and craftspeople that had different kinds of windows and different trying to basically make the walls a little more open. But no architect is necessary because the initial plan already existed. It was, you know, basically defined by the Catholic Church. There are also great examples of buildings in Europe that are made of engineers that do have a lot of architecture, and they're called castles, right? Because the primary job of the castle is to be a bastion. They can look like, you guys ever seen a castle? They look really weird, incoherent. They're not particularly pretty, but they do a couple of things very, very well, right? There are places where people can sustain and live for a pretty long period of time through siege, and their walls are strong enough to withstand attacks. So those were engineering exercises where they had to know about the materials and the standards to use them. So they weren't a whole lot of architects. Formal architects started emerging in the Renaissance. So when I talk about formal architect, because there was a big conflation at that time between architects and engineers, a lot of times people talk about themselves as engineers and then refer to themselves as the planners of the project. And it really got at what was really the key thinking, which is that a lot of the challenges that architects want to face, they can't face until craft and engineering are mature enough that the building could be built in a consistent state. In other words, once you realize how to build the skyscraper with all the rules, the details of the skyscraper, then you can have a conversation with the architect. But until you figure out how to keep that skyscraper falling down, the architect's needs are a lot less urgent. So what that means is that it's emergent. It can only exist once the managed practitioners have laid a foundation of maturity. That's really important. We'll talk about that when it comes to software, because that's one of the core reasons we can see it much right here. And formal architecture matters most when difficult or new idea or stressor must be understood in the context of what has to be built. What I mean by stressor is the complexity of making new technologies or techniques, or an vision of a new cultural or aspirational goal and part of your mission. To me, that's one reason I think in the 20th century the architect is such a superstar. Because the 20th century, and really from about the 1850 on, is just a story of constant change and challenges in the environment, different ideas people are trying to grapple with in the world. And the architect is a way of trying to make sense of those things. So, how do they do it? Well, key thing about architecture
transformational analysis to discover the true intent of science based on a higher level understanding of the new. And this happens to me formally in all acts of creation. When I talk about transformational analysis, when you're playing with something, you're writing a song on a piano, and this was your to a guitar, that's transformational analysis. You're making that change. You start with the idea that it works in one context, and then you're building something else meaningful in another context. What's different about architecture that happens in a really large scope, it happens in the scope of an entire project. Usually transformational analysis happens at the level of craft, which is one of the reasons that architects get along pretty well with agile folks in terms of talking about the processes involved, even if they have a lot of experience on the scope. So when we talk about analysis, it's really important to understand the difference between analysis and design. Analysis is a process of identifying exceptions, figuring out what patterns exist and what to do about them. Design is the synthetic process of solving problems. So once you understand the space that you're working in, then design can occur. But we're not going to talk a lot about design. I think design is literally one of the most important things that we're going to do. And it's critically important. I think the gift of architecture usually brings the conversation, giving people, inviting people to a place where they can do that design confidently with a lot of understanding and better alignment with the rest of the project. So since most of this work is about the powers of transformational analysis, I want to differentiate it to the kind of analysis we're most familiar with, which is decompositional analysis. This is the analysis that almost everybody does almost all the time. The iterative breakdown of broader concepts in more detail through additional analysis. Has anybody ever done a trace of linear matrix? Has anybody ever done an object decomposition model where they were doing inheritance during an object? Yeah, that's decomposition analysis, which is fine and good. But basically, each step is a tracing journey towards the ultimate distillation of detail. And it's fractal in nature. So the larger thing looks a great deal like the smaller thing, except there's less detail to be understood. The most common example of this would be a work chart. Each box contains smaller boxes made by people responsible for doing things related to the larger box. There's a lot of similarity to what a box contains of a series of roles and functions. That larger box contains a larger set of roles and functions, or a more important set of roles and functions, but the activities are largely the same. So it's a way to set a placeholder for work without really understanding the high-level details. It's often assumed the answer to the important questions that come later as the analysis continues. So, you know, this breaking down smart pieces can be very useful. But sometimes, without understanding that idea at that larger level, we're really completely without creating a way to complete model, you run the risk of misunderstanding what's really going on. Transformation analysis assumes that every model is important. And there will be a resemblance to the idea you start with. But there's going to be utility within each transformation. In other words, the model that we have here is useful and meaningful for people to have a conversation. It may not be the same model here. Now, this model may model B might be created by model. But you're not necessarily going to draw a straight line between the two. And going back to the story graph example, this is probably the most common example of transformation analysis in software development, which is that story graphs are nothing like the one within. Anybody who spent time talking about agile software development to look at these story graphs knows that they're effectively a way of creating an effective project management structure, planning, and sequence, trying to get a general understanding of what happened forward. The work itself is almost stupidly different. Right? It is different models, it is different ways of solving problems. So the cards transform in the sprint into other ways of doing the work that are appropriate and specific to the need. But they are not overlapped. So decomposition is the core process of engineers and planners. Transformation is part of the core process of crafters and architects. But it's different scales. So crafters are going to do it in a more localized level, architects are doing it in a project level. This is a known thing. Anytime, if you guys ever go watch a video about information about architecture in the built world, you will basically get this story. They don't use exactly these words, but they will talk about these transformations in the same kind of way. In fact, I have links to an architecture series at the end of the talk that you can watch, where this is the mentality being described. So, where is it in software? I mean, the thing that's really interesting about this is that we see little flashes of it, right? I mean, it exists kind of in the agile process. But the thing that's really interesting about, to me, about software is that software has been a 70-year-old argument between engineers and craftsmen. And I don't mean that in a bad way, and I'll explain why in a minute. But the key to software products has been engineers and craftsmen, and it's just a battle about which way to do it, you know, flowing back and forth, waterfall. Agile, safe, all the stuff that you're talking about. And this is part of this is that remember, architecture cannot exist if it can be not mature. I mean, let's think about this. Alan Turing wrote the non-computer numbers book on paper in 1936. And that was simply the implication that you could basically abstract away mathematical problems into an algorithm. Peter Morville. And Lou Rosenthal wrote Information Architecture for the World in 1998. It took 1,000 years for Europe to discover architecture after the fall of Roman Empire. What could it be? Hopefully, a little faster. But remember, they cannot, architects cannot exceed until engineers and craftsmen create a mature space. And that's what's been going on, really, for the last 80 years. We've had engineering programs, algorithmic and technical standardization. You know, it's so exciting. Some of the most exciting examples of engineering machinery were things like error theory, championed by Margaret Hamilton. Anybody heard of Margaret Hamilton? You know who she was? She saved the last two missions of Apollo. She invented error theory. The first was Apollo 8, and she predicted the astronauts would crash the whole system at some point during the flight, and they needed to restart it. And, you know, nobody would believe it because they were astronauts. Right? And then they did. And her team uploaded basically Apollo in the dark. They had no way of managing navigation or control of the spacecraft as it curved towards the moon. Her team uploaded via radio telemetry and timer software program. And if they didn't get it right, Apollo would either crash in the moon or run off in space. So she got it right and got back. And then she built an air handling and a priority handling system for handling all the demands on such processing units as the moon. Modules trying to get on the moon. So basically, she invented, there's actually a technical term for it, she invented the prioritization of basically air handling and threading. Right? She did this back in 1967. So, critical engineering decisions based on process and hardware experience. Anybody who's written C++ or Java knows that stuff ran through the bones of software. Untyped variables, all that stuff that everybody knows right now, people were still really worried about memory base in 1996. So this was a big, big deal because the engineering challenge and concerns were very real. Crafting, of late, the more pressing towards the learning design of craft, basically creating a language for talking about how to build software. And the biggest advance is obviously design patterns, right? You know, they relate to the idea that crafts will be consistent tools for understanding higher-level abstractions that are ultimately reality of modern software. Christopher Alexander, who is actually a big really described this idea, and then was expanded by a number of thinkers in the 70s and 23 years. You know, the key thing about the object models is that we capture the important actors in the systems and movements as well, they tend to be stable, and they also capture operational relationships, mostly to give us a language for talking about stuff that is easily transferable as we present those in the world. Tools for describing the built world. But it's not architecture. So, the engineers develop, the craftsmen develop, and these were the kinds of problems that exist in software, right? And since these were the kinds of problems that exist in software, there were certain failures that emerged as a result of the failure in those domains. One of the greatest ironies of software development is that engineers ran the project manager of almost every software project until about 1990. And they sucked at it. We're terrible at it, right? Sometimes I can't figure this out, but basically the failures were epic. And usually failures are probably sort of attention. It turned out engineering approaches are really bad at measuring the effort that we could build software. The failure rates of things that are built, sometimes the thing basically takes over the company, right? It also means engineers can be so overwhelmed by the complexity, they don't know what tools they have, and how to scope something, so basically they copy from another domain. And in doing so, this critical details of the derailed project resulted in things that don't work, that were catastrophic and wrong. curious, you know, and they're standing on the shoulders of the engineering successes. They have solid computers that work. They have things that operate well. They have giant memory processes for handling objects, which is something that Bob Royce will tell you, anybody who will hear about how hard it was to actually get objects to work on a 386 or a processor. So they have that advantage, but they're, so their failures tend to be annoying and dispiriting, a problem of understanding the context, right? I mean, if you really think about that as a crafting board of modern software, these teams rely on the mechanisms of understanding the context, and those break down for whatever reason the software is going to do. You might end up with individual elements, but well built with poor integrated coherence detection, which is a common problem. Actual needs are submitted, but often ignored. The things that are made to match the perception of the crafters, but not really the perception of the organization. And that's all old. Right? Going from this to this. This is an actual unicorn about 20,000 years ago. Looked at North America, snarling beyond belief. But hey, it's a mammal, it's got a horn. It's got hooves, it eats grass. It's kind of mythological because we've never seen it. That's a unicorn, right? No, it's not a unicorn. So, epic failures, the spirit of failures, right? And, you know, the thing that's really interesting is that this is okay. The art of making software is deeply flawed. All these issues about, I have no idea how to build this, and we build it completely, we don't just make these problems to the software delivered, but it's a disappointment. It's a disappointment. But now people expect more. And we need a new language for addressing those expectations. 45% success rate's not good enough. Nah, it shouldn't be good enough. We can do better. Because we know we can do better because in the built world, evidence exists to be better. All right. So the problem is, people having the argument about how to do it better are engineers who are not speaking. So whether they double down or they not, right? So engineers double down on full decomposition, or iterative decomposition. Crafters double down on process. And we have this situation where we're swimming back and forth and the same kinds of mistakes are being missed on many different ways. I believe that architecture can help solve the problem. And to remind you, this is kind of like studying a quantum physics for electrons. Like, here's a tug over here where stuff works, and here's where stuff is not and it doesn't. So I'm hypothesizing that this is what's going on. Alright? What we seem to get with projects is happy stakeholders, project completion deadline, true integration with other resolutions, and success rates far beyond those of current software projects. For the last 7 years, they've been missed the word TUG. And I think it's because TUG is really focused on the true nature of architecture in disciplines of things of both. The last 8 years have been spent maturing and understanding engineering practical performance and explaining what we need to make. So, which is what we need before it's impossible. So remember, the process of a particular discipline is the same regardless of the domain, but the specific ways that that discipline is applied varies from domain to domain. When you build stuff as a building architecture, you need to know about height, spaces, the way things look in a particular area. If you're a naval architect, you have to understand how you want stability, how things are going to actually look, and so on. When they're actually in the water, what happens if they have enough seams. So what are the things that an information architecture needs to know in the world of software? It seems to me that the key tool, the technique of information architecture, is many ways wrong. And I think I want to talk about this for a little bit because this is actually, if I had to say that basically, what I believe is that when we talk about modeling and meaning is modeling, it's literally the most important thing we talk about software. Models are a way to measure the world in some part of the fundamental truth. Can we tell the truth of this model? Could you build software against this picture of the world? And the reason we have to use models is because software is not reality. Software is not physics. We do not have a physics to apply to software. We can make metaphors, visual metaphors, and cognitive metaphors that have to do with what's going on in the world and how we see the contemporary world. Well, no, this is very good. I understand the context. But at the end of the day, visual places are essentially a built world of diverse and interlocking models. The level of density that's unheard of anything else we're doing. Anything else in the world except if you sit around and think about philosophy, smoking, some would even say that their expression is cognitive structures of language. Modeling, and the other thing that's really important is modeling some learning established discipline itself, which models all the time. We just think about this. How many people here worked on Amazon in the last 2 days? Has anyone not on Amazon last week? My daughter's really into the world. How many models are on this page? I'm just like in the lobby, it's just quick little. Did you get your files? Did you think you have 5 models on this page?
8 models
on this page? I think there are 8 or 9 models on this page, depending on how you think about the organization, the fast time, and so on. Right? And this is only a fraction of the model of the page you're going to get on Amazon. You have this giant scroll of people with recommendations, and you have people also liking them. We are saturated in models of information and understanding in the modern world. So, the thing that's really important about the models is that if we can talk about the world in this way, we can use them to figure things out that are broadly shared. Right? There's a challenge to trying to talk about systems with this level of complexity and abstraction. It's really hard. Language is actually really bad. By language, I mean the formal way when I say a sentence and you hear the sentence and think about it and try to understand what I say and say it back. That's actually really hard to do in the visual world, right? So instead, we have this opportunity that for our models are a good way to overcome these obstacles. We can create a model where we can, through research, provide a basis for mutual understanding and help us to do good with language. Right. So, anybody disagree with this kind of crazy talk? Right. Hey, we're already doing it, right? No, we could be doing it. So the essence of what architects will bring to the conversation is that people in software and operate model. And I don't think they're bad at it, I don't think they don't try. I just think that they're not great at it in the way that it's going to work transformation analysis. Digital places are essentially a built world of diverse and interactive models, but the underlying information philosophy of meaning those models is not always understood. Sometimes there's a cargo hold or a checkbox quality of what's going on in the model, and you just have to show that you've mapped something out in such a way that somebody else can turn it into code transformation, and you don't necessarily ask questions. For example, object models are spatial patterns. Right. It's a facet, it's an attribute in an object model. When you talk about an entity and attribute in an object model, you're changing. Do entity objects actually exist? These sound like really great philosophical questions, but they're not. It turns out to be really, really important. And the more you play with object models, the more you think about what they might mean and how the implications are, you don't have to answer this question, but you have to know why they exist. And architects are meaning-based modeling is going to get you closer to that. Modeling is already an established discipline of software. Most models are used as problem-solving activities for designers to work on problems. The best modelers models any project you develop. And they are really, really good at it. They don't care about the big picture necessarily. You know, we might have some system architects who are going to spikes, but again, this is all from agilemodeling.com. These are all models that are designed to solve a problem in Spring. With the exception of the persona is one or two sentences. I'm not sure what I can do with that in a persistent and long-term perspective. So, you know, sometimes the models are treated only as a tool and for the really short-term perspective. And we really want to expand the scope of things. And the reason for that is, you know, look, these are the children of practice. They need models. They're going to build the world. The unbuilt world cannot be understood. Architects aren't saying that the unbuilt world can be understood. The conversation about it. So, this is the challenge that information architects really want to address. But Tuck is going to do a better job than any other place I've ever seen. By the way, this isn't a picture of Tuck. Tuck's a great company. I love Tuck. They're doing something I've never seen before, and I just happen to be where it's happening. So, I'm using them as a case study for this thought process. I want everybody to do this. I want everybody to do this. Most modeling is not that sufficient scope, sufficient rigor, with an eye towards transforming and understanding. Can your models convey meaning without further decomposition? Those are useful right now. Are they applicable to people outside your department? Are they durable? Will they sustain their truth beyond the scope of a single sprint? Your model, the value of your model is whether or not people are going to still be talking about it in a useful way 3 months from now when things get rough on a project and things always get rough. Right? Do they surface in the intentions and concepts rather than feeling like a puzzle or an exercise in aesthetic arrangement? In other words, am I building something unique and new as opposed to mapping up in some standard process that I did before, because that's engineering, it's not architecture? Do they reflect some fundamental truth of the world? So, it's this progress is uneven. There are people who are really starting to get this in the world, particularly who are really mature software development environments and are really puzzled because their software is still not succeeding, right? Does anybody know this guy? He's just burning a path in Europe right now talking about how technical there is in the region. It's a big deal. And what he basically talks about is the nature of how modeling is the most important thing. Now, he is an enterprise architect. And so product managers, system architects, and enterprise architects are increasingly the champions of this need for solving problems. And he's not asking small questions, he's asking big ones. Like, what is the fundamental meaning of the value of this organization? Can we map it discreetly? How often will it change? What happens when we do change it? Are there additional metaphors we have to prepare for 6 months down the road? These are the kinds of questions he's asking. He's trying to model the fundamental nature and truth of the systems that he's in. So what does the future hold for software projects that go big with information architecture? Well, like I said, it's already happening at Tuttle. But I think the most important thing is that this is not a critique or a combination of the astonishing, remarkable, admirable work that's been done by other people in the software world. This is an invitation to say that we're ready to take the next step. And what that means is that practice engineers can focus on code quality, performance, enterprise integration, data integrity, design, and engineering, things they want to do with those stuff. Right? Not everyone is an architect. I don't think I'm an architect, to be perfectly honest. I came in as a business analyst and a person with some scientific background to help with some of the marketing and business structures that Tuttle has, but I think about things very, very differently than other people, and that's okay. Architects are a very specific mindset. But having these things in the world can be incredibly powerful. So part of this is when you say, are you information architects? Because the future needs you, right? This is what I would say is if you're curious about this, if you're a kind of person who likes to play with models, who really is always trying to get to the fundamental truth, who's really, really good at talking to lots of people in lots of different disciplines, craftspeople, engineers. If you have already done something where you made a really cool diagram that people said, this is great, this helps me understand exactly what I have to do, and they just walked around talking about it. If you go up to the whiteboard and draw a picture, and for some reason that picture seems to click with people, even if it's not the formal model of what's going to get done, you might be an architect. Okay? So, I just really want to invite you to think about this, because the next 10 years are really going to be this. We are in a position where the ability to understand the big questions of projects at a high level are going to make a difference between software as dispiriting, the software misinformed, as Adam was talking about, the things where the ability is aligned with the fundamental truths of what the organization is trying to achieve. And this is the quote that I think of all the time. Being an architect means really spreading out to the world, let them be educated, skillful with the pencil, instructed in geometry, knowledge, history, by following the philosophers with attention, understanding who's have some knowledge of medicine, and the opinions of the jurists, and be acquainted with the astronomy and theory of the heavens. So it sounds like a little harsh to read something. But if you see modeling as a way to show yourself skillful with pencil, instructed in geometry, your next decade is going to be deeply fun to solve. I need you. I really believe that. I'm going to leave you with a few thoughts that you can play with if you want to look at this. Doug Patton has a really nice YouTube series called How to Design an Architect. The Vitruvius Template is an architecture 45 pages long. And I would say that these three books are really, really useful as a way to start to think about the context. The other thing I would say is encourage you to do any model that you possibly can as much as you can and see if you can use it to tell a story that is transformative and persistent across the project. Thanks a lot.
I really appreciate that. I know it was a little technical probably for some people, but I actually work at an enterprise software company, so it was bang on. So I guess we have engineer architects, and when you were showing some of the slides and describing some of the things, that doesn't fit. It should fit, but it doesn't fit.
Tell me more, which can you give in particular?
The slide in particular where you were talking about the quote.
Oh.
The quote. Yeah, exactly.
You're not an architect.
That's not an architect?
No, this is an architect. They're not.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so actually, I'm a UX designer who is working in the area of analysis. And so I feel more connection because that's the conversations I'm having with the architects and engineering and everybody at the company. So I guess, do you have any particular suggestions? How spread the word, how to continue to build this idea?
So the historical cause of this problem, I'll say to a few weeks ago, we'll have to talk to you. Architecture, the conflation of architecture and engineering is something that has gone basically it's off project lost, right? There was a period, especially in the late 20th century, where the architect was basically the person responsible for pulling all the plans, making sure everything got run. It was sort of considered to be the important leader on the project, so it represents a leadership position. Very often what you see in those situations is the leadership position that's got a more engineering disciplinary domain, which is where architect is really more architectural activity they're carrying out. So what you really want to do is you want to ask them how they think about stuff. How do you solve a problem? Are you solving it based on standards or processes? Is this a transformational question or a decomposition question? I thought that last talk was so good. Because I have trouble getting architects before I really strong opinions, but really starting to explore the truth of what they mean when they say they're doing work a certain way is more important than the language they use. If architect is a true language, but ask them how they're solving the problem, then figure out what's missing from the project. And because a lot of times they think that if I'm an architect, I have got the holistic view of the world. Well, the holistic, you've got a checklist of holistic things that you'd like to have in terms of having a holistic view of the world. Do we have it? How do we get there? That's how I approach it.
Hi, I apologize if this is an ignorant question because I'm not an information architect, but to use...
Maybe you are.
But to use your analogy of engineering a building versus an architect of a building, are there building codes for
yes.
software, like standards that
for
us has within the UC coming?
There are lots of codes. Yeah. They're harder to. I don't feel qualified to have this conversation to the extent the problem deserves, but the short version is people have been trying to figure out ways to build code using standards for a really long time. And the capability of Turing model is an old version where number of errors, number of bugs per thousand lines of code, have seen many more than five organizational assessments of how many checkpoints you have. They call it architecture. In fact, TOGAF, which is the standard high-level enterprise architecture system, basically, this is what you have to do to build a enterprise software thing. It's a bunch of checklists, just. But there's no understanding.
Right.
So that's the real challenge. Yes, it'd be nice if we had high-quality code. The best thing about the agile software development process is that it's making better codes, their disciplines better, the understanding of making things better, the quality of code better, just not the fact that the craft is. But asking a question about what is important in solving the problem hasn't been asked in terms of saying, how do you understand what you're doing?
It looks like that's it. Thank you, Dan. Oh, wait, is there another one? Oh, sorry, I did not see it. We do have time for another one,
okay.
So.
By the way, if you completely disagree with me, I'm totally fine with that. This is a super great system. I would love to talk to someone.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan, for your I really appreciate your talk. I did have a question about you mentioning that no design, no coding can improve a bad model.
I didn't say that.
Or physical training?
Yes. A much more competent person who's, that's why I want to put out.
I just wanted to ask you, are there any characteristics of a good model? What exactly is a good model? If it's a bad model, then what is a good model?
So this took about a year. A good model, as far as I can tell, and this is maybe a conversation to have with the architects of Tubbs, so I don't rush that, is effective in creating understanding, and you know it's effective in creating understanding because you continue to use it, and people continue to agree that that's the model of 3 minutes. So it's really a weird thing to describe. I would say there are ways to determine alignment. Tubbs has a really powerful tool called performance continuum, where you basically have a bunch of people in a room and using an exercise where they vote on a number of things, you can get really strong alignment, and it's very profound. It seems to bring people together in a very specific way. And that model works over and over and over again. But the key thing about it is people walk in and say, yes, I agree, this is what we need. And more importantly, and this is another thing to do, actually, is I would also suggest this all the time, it's never just one model. It's as many models as possible that are kind of cutting across the same question in a different way. So make then clients advice to make models of different models, see which ones can understand them further. So is there just one? That one response, is there just one model? Make check that and add down as well. Again, Dan Klein, see if Dan could be a senior model, what is it behind you? Give me some thoughts on that. I'm not sure.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.